it's on balancing a balance sheet, especially for forecast period. My reason for choosing this topic is because in my training sessions, I noticed that when we get to the balance sheet, especially people who already are very strong in accounting knowledge, people who already have some background around corporate finance and they do this day in, day out, when every other thing I do up until here, income statement, some of the projections and all, they kind of get it, you know, either they already know it or immediately I mention it, they get it. But when we get to balance sheet, it takes them a bit of time. So you notice that this is something that becomes a bit meaty for them. So I decided I'm going to do a session purely on balance sheet. Yes, with the IFRS, it's in statement of financial position. And like I tell people in the US, they don't follow IFRS. So you just there's no sin in keep calling it balance sheet. All right, so this is the practice file I'm going to use. And I'm going to start from where things build up, kind of. So you see that there's the income statement, which people kind of are familiar with. There's the balance sheet. So I'm going to try to do a hurried breakdown of the balance sheets. First of all, to follow the IFRS standards, since that's what we use in Nigeria currently. Okay, Mr. Akeem, you want to say something? I see your audio is up. It's as if you are saying something.
Sorry. I think I'll just join.
No problem. So I'm going to, first of all, bring up, because I don't know what audience we have, let me start with what I feel is a bit less daunting. So let's start with something from a textbook side, and then we now take it to the model side. Okay, great. So following the IFRS standard, which is what we use in Nigeria and, well, Europe, Nigeria, most countries in Africa also. So the balance sheet, which is a statement of financial position. Am I starting from the top? Okay, yeah, this is the top. As we all know, it's to show the assets, the liabilities, and the equity, right? And we all know that assets is equal to the liabilities plus equity. So that's what I mean by balancing the balance sheet. Whenever you do your projections, for Historica, it's not a problem. Why? There is no way you will have a financial statement of the Historica that did not balance. It will balance. Whoever is preparing the book must balance it. So that one, except if you are the one preparing the book, then it's more of reconciliation, finding out what figures you have incorrectly entered. Okay. This is the projection where there's a structure to it. And if you don't follow that structure, it will never balance. You know, I've seen people that whenever they send me their financial projections, their financial statement, the projection side or model, and I go to change a figure somewhere and I see that the model does not balance anymore. Maybe they put their price at for unit price, they put it at maybe 500 naira per unit. And then I go there and say, oh, what if we change this thing to 600 naira per unit? And their balance sheet refuses to balance. You know what has happened? They did not follow the proper way. So they manually balanced it. Yeah, if there's a word like that. So most times people just pack whatever is not balancing the balance sheet. They pack it to other current assets or other fixed assets or other current liabilities. Those are where they normally pack them. Yes, it will work at least for a one time, so that the thing balances and you move on with your life, but it's not correct. So let's quickly just go through. If you have any question on these items, you can always raise your hand, signify, or put in the chat box. I'm monitoring the chat box. So number one is assets. So let's quickly just look at the possible breakdowns. So the moment you start your balance sheet, you start with the asset, then you start with the non-current assets. So we have the plant, property, and equipment, which is kind of straightforward. You know, then we have the investment property. So these are properties that are earning you income. They are like revenue generating properties. Then we have intangible assets. So things like software, goodwill, patents, things you acquire anyway that are not tangible. Then we have deferred tax assets, which, yeah, it's when the difference in tax on your accounting books and the government tax falls on an asset side for you. So this one, for historical, you will always have for forecast. You most times we just try to stay neutral. So we try to say, okay, the same way government is going to treat your depreciation or capital allowances, the way you two have captured it in your income statement. But the key thing is, it's not too much of a problem when you are forecasting this. If you don't know how to forecast it and you decided to just, keep it at not changing, maintaining whatever is on the books, nobody's going to argue with you. Nobody's going to take a bone of contention with you over that. Other assets is anything that doesn't fall into these explicit categories. If you have investments that are, so these are kind of like financial investments, So because IFRS requires a lot, every year they keep trying to make people to be more elaborate in their disclosure. So normally all of these will have been financial assets. But if you see what they are doing, they want you to break them down so that you don't just lump everything together. They want to see the ones that are accounted for by equity method. They want to see the ones that are by fair value that is not equity based, kind of. It's not like you took the equity value. You just look at what's the market value for those financial assets, and you report at them. And so this could be things that are not trading on the secondary market. So you will have to explain your methodology of coming to the fair value. Financial assets at fair price through profit or loss, similar, but this one is, through profit or loss. Then financial asset at amortized cost. Some of these things I don't know deeply the breakdown because, to be sincere, I've never had to work on a company that had all of these line items in their books. So this is a documentation that shows the max possible. Okay, so derivative financial asset options and anything that is like a contract of futures anyway are purely derivative. So anything you have, maybe you entered some contract, forward contract with some people to get dollars, to get some things, they wanted to report it. If it's on an asset side for you, then it should be captured separately. Held to maturity investment, any investment that you're going to hold to maturity. So this again is still financial assets, kind of assets that you are planning to sell. They're already put on the market for sale. So, other loans and receivables, these are now loans that you gave out to other people. So you are the one who is going to receive it. It's not like loans that you take. Remember, we are on the asset side. Then you do the total side. So I hope this is clear. I hope nobody is confused. Let me see if I can share with us this. Let me just quickly do that. So you can always take a look at it after today's session. So I'm already clicking what we shared. So once that one opens, I'll do the sharing. Not to take too much time, let me quickly go to the current asset side. So current assets are the assets that you are expected to use up within a 1 year period. Let me not say the current financial year, 1 year period anyway. So inventories, we all know inventories. Other current assets, if you ask me, I would have preferred to put these other current assets at the bottom. I don't know, that's the way they decided to arrange theirs. So anything that doesn't fall under all these explicit categories, you will definitely come put under other current assets. So contract assets, whenever you enter into some kind of contracts where the thing is an asset for you, not a liability for you, then you report it here. But on the current side, things you're supposed to enjoy within the current within 1 year, like current year, let me use that word. Trade receivables. So people who are owing you money, customers who had bought stuffs but they have not paid, comes under here. Then other financial asset at amortized cost. So it's very similar to what we saw here. Just that what we saw here is for the long-term asset side. So the whichever portion of it that is for the current asset side is going to come here. Then other receivables that are not maybe related to your trades. Then derivative financial instruments. Maybe one day I will do a session purely on derivative. It's not so common in Nigeria, But now it's becoming common because even me, as small as my organization or some of the things I do are, occasionally I get into derivatives. You'll be like, how did I get into derivatives? So take, for instance, there's a portion of our business that requires us getting raw materials, well, digital raw materials anyway, in USD. And so you all know how dollar goes up and down, right? So what do? We speak to someone who normally earns in dollar, and then sometimes we lock a rate. So we enter into a kind of relationship where we say, okay, for the next 1 month, you know, I'm just generalizing it. It's not specifically the way I'm saying it. So we could say for the next 1 month, you give us like X dollar amount and we are going to buy it at exactly this USD. And then the moment it's consummated anyway, then that happens. Sometimes the person gives us some dollar ahead, or we give him naira ahead, or whichever way. The key thing is it's a forward contract. So it's a something that I'm going to enjoy in the future, and it's going to come as an asset to me. Then it comes in here. If it's going to come as a liability, it will also come in. We'll get to the liability side. So that's that one. And if you enter into the ones that are, I don't know if some of you have tried to use this agriculture commodities exchange. So if you buy some things, but now in your company's name on the commodities exchange, then it will also come in here. So that one becomes futures, not forward contract. So anyway, so moving on, financial assets held at value, at fair value, exactly what we said here, but now the current side of it, and ultimately cash is always going to be sitting here. So that if you have assets held for sale that are going to be sold within this current year, like you expect to close that sale very, very soon, then it comes here. Total current asset, then with that you have your total asset, which is the total non-current asset plus the total current asset. So now let's go to the liability side. On the liability side, obviously you have borrowings, loans, okay? So again, we are starting with the non-current one. So loans, money you borrowed from financial institutions or anybody that is going to give you as a loan anyway. So that one comes here. Then tax, which I told us can be a liability or an asset. When it's an asset is when it comes here. And then when it's on the liability side is when it comes here. So when the difference between your accounting tax and the government tax leads to a liability on your book, you know, then it's reflected here. Okay, then all your provisions, you know, employee benefit obligations. So long, if you are a company that normally pays gratuity and every 10 years, employees will have to get some benefits, you know, so you want to be accruing them such that even if you've not yet paid them, you know, that it's carried on your book so that it's slowly building up. Then provisions, other provisions too, similar like that. Then, interestingly, I would say there should be other non-current liabilities here too. But provisions can be said to be a catch-all word for all other non-current liabilities. Okay, so you have the total current liabilities. And then we go to the current liabilities side. We have the trade and pay other payables, money that you owe your suppliers. Then there's the contract. By the way, I hope you hear me clearly. If my voice is having some background noise or all, please let me know. I have three mics. You know, I have this one, I have this one, and I have the laptop mic, so I can always switch to a better one. Then we have contract liabilities, just as we have contract assets. When it's on the liability side, when liabilities mean you are the one who needs to pay up, you know, then it shows up in current liabilities. And then you have, obviously, you always have your current tax liabilities, whatever the government have billed you to pay for that particular financial year. Then short-term borrowings, any of your borrowings that is meant to be cleared out this particular year, you know, or that is less than 1 year kind of a borrowing. So maybe like bank overdraft and such corporate bonds that are like commercial paper. Derivative financial instruments. So remember what I said, that when these derivatives here, it's now a case where you are the one who needs to settle it. You know, you've enjoyed the dollars, you've not yet paid the person the naira. You know, then here it's going to come up that particular thing. If it's a forward contract, if it's a futures, then that means you are the one selling. So you've sold. You know, when you sell me this, let me give you an example of. I'm going to try and do a session on this derivative because I think it's not so very well understood. People misunderstand it. Imagine that I'm a trader on the. This is the thing that is closest to me. Let me look for something that is like a paper or say. Anyway, we can use this as a certificate. So I am a trader. Anybody can be a trader. It's not so complicated. I'm a trader on the, let's take commodity exchange, right? So maybe I own a farm, I farm maize, and then I signed up on the FX commodity exchange, and then I met whatever their requirements are, they've certified, and then I'm putting for contract a bag of maize, right? So I'm going to supply you this maybe this is the contract document. So you pay me 100,000 naira per bag of maize. But now that bag of maize, you are not paying me to supply you today. So I'm going to supply you in December. So I've sold you because it's on an exchange, so it's going to be a futures. I've sold you a futures contract where you've paid me. The money is going to be in my hand right now, right? But I need to settle you with that whatever it is I'm going to give you in December. So that's a liability for me because I've enjoyed the money and I'm the one who is going to pay. But for you, it's going to be an asset, you know, because you've paid for it and you are hoping to enjoy it in the next 3 years, 3 months, I mean. And then employee or benefit obligation that you need to settle this current year. So whoever of your staff that is already leaving or is already due for his 10th year benefits or stuff like that. Then another thing that are on the current side, any financial obligations, they fall under provisions. And so that brings us to total liabilities. Okay. Then we go to the equity side. So obviously, yes, your share capital and share premium. Okay, so they bundle it. It's common to bundle it together anyway. I think there was a session where someone was asking a question about this. And we opened many financial, I think we opened like 3 different companies, Nestle and I don't know, 2 other companies. And yeah, it's common to have it bundled together anyway. Then any other equity line items, if you have reserves, you know, maybe by law, by revaluation reserve or whatever reserve that you have to carry in your book, it's usually out of the equity. And then retain any, all the monies that you've been making, you know, accumulated, and hopefully you pay dividends from some of them. Okay, so all that together form your total equity. Now that I've done a taking us through, so Mr. Akim is asking, what's the difference between share capital and share premium? So share capital is... So when you are starting a company, you always have to start it with an authorized shares and money kind of. So in your starting document, in your registration document, right, you're going to have, we are starting a company, we are starting Akim Limited with 1 billion authorized shares at 50 kobo per share, right? So your share capital is that amount. Hopefully, in Nigeria, I don't know if it's compulsory you pay anymore. Let's leave that for another story completely. So what you start it up with, what is on the documentation when you guys were incorporating the company? And the only way you can change your share capital, you must go and refile your documentation. You must have to go back to Nigeria to CAC. I don't know what form they will give you to do a change on your share capital structure, but that one is there right from the day you start the business, okay? But the truth is that as the company is growing, if 4 of you started the business with 500 million naira and you add an issuance of 1 billion shares at 50 kobo, so your share capital is that 500 million naira. As the business is growing, let's take someone from among us. So if Mr. Sadiq decides to join your company and he needs to put up some money as an investor to become an equity holder in your business, you're not going to sell to him at the same 50 kobo per share, right? Hopefully you shouldn't do that. So maybe you sell to him at 2 naira per share. So you see the difference. So maybe out of four of you all gave out 100,000 unit shares. That's 400,000 unit shares. But you didn't sell it to him at the price at which your company was incorporated. You sold it to him at times four. Instead of 50 kobo per share, you sold it at 2 naira per share. So you see that there's an additional 1 naira 50 kobo on top of the 400 shares you sold. So that's like a shared premium. Sometimes we call it additional paid in capital. So whatever grammar that you might come across that is different from the share capital. So share premium, that's the additional money on top of what is already recorded in the books. And it reflects that the more a company is growing, obviously, the more when other people are joining it, they have to pony up a larger amount of money. So I hope I didn't confuse you. That's just what it is. So with that part over with, I said I was going to upload this. Maybe I'll upload it at the end so that I don't take too much of our time and we can do the practical side. So, and this is the practical side. What am I going to do? I'm going to just do a quick renaming. Oh, thank you, sir. You've confirmed that I did not confuse us. So I'm going to do a quick renaming and delete what I have. Okay, so I'm going to delete everything that is here so that I do them again. Okay, good. So I want to do a balance sheet from scratch. We've already understood all these line items, so that's why I didn't delete them. That's just what we just finished. So my intangible assets is going to come from where? It's coming from. I have somewhere where I have put all the asset classes. So I go there and I go and pick what the intangible asset is. So the intangible asset is this one. If you look at my screen, you see CapEx, net book value. So this is the value for intangible asset. Maybe I'll show you where I'm picking these values from. I already have a sheet where I've done the calculations of depreciation, capital expenditure, but more importantly, this is the part we are using. So let me just color this part so it becomes easy for you to. So this is the part I'm using for my balance sheet, the carrying value. So it's also called the carrying value. I usually call it net book value. All those are just tomato, tomato. It's the same thing. So I'm going to come in here and pick also for the all the other fixed assets that fall under plant, property, and equipment. So if I go here, those ones are building, plant, vehicle, office, furniture, and PP&E. So I'm going to pick them all, one, two, three, four, five. So these ones together form my PP&E. Okay, good. Then other fixed assets for this company that we are doing for, I don't have anything that falls under other fixed assets, So I am going to leave that place. Then I can sum up all of these. That becomes my non-current assets. Okay. Then for the current assets. So for the current asset, I have a sheet, working capital sheet, where I have done the calculations of the different how much of our money from sales is going to be stuck with customer and that will be trade receivable. How much of our money that we are supposed to pay suppliers are we going to hold back on and not pay them immediately, How much inventory are we going to hold? So all those ones typically. And it's very straightforward. It's just for me to go pick them. Working capital, trade receivable. I'm sorry, inventory. Is inventory. Inventory is number 14. And then I'm going to drag this. Then trade receivable. Trade receivable is also going to come from there. How much are we being held by our customers? Other current assets. The current assets. Once I'm done, if you have any question about any particular one, the calculation of it, I can always go to the where place I calculated it and we'll do it together. Okay. But if I'm going jumping like that, you will be confused. So it's better I do one place at a time. Then if you say, oh, Michael, I don't understand how you got this value, can you go and show how we calculate it? Then definitely I'll go and do that. So cash and cash equivalent, it's only going to come up after we do cash flow statement, which means a lot of time you will not know it ahead. So it's the last thing we do. Take this and run. Then total assets. So total assets is going to be the summation of the non-current asset and the current assets. Okay. Okay. So we go now to the debt portion. So usually the debt, you should have done somewhere where you have explained all the money you are going to borrow, the loans you will take, and how you are going to pay them back, you know, more like a loan schedule. So with that information, the closing value or the carrying value of the loan becomes your what you take to the balance sheet. So I've already done something like that. We are borrowing 50 million naira in what year now? In year 2019. And then this is how we're going to repay it, spread over, I think it's a five-year loan. So it's spread over the next 5 years. And blah blah, how we're going to pay it back and interest expense and all of that. I'm able to get the closing value. So by the time I remove the amount that we hold at the start of the period, sorry, let me rephrase that. If I remove how much we paid as part of principal repayment from what was outstanding at the start of the period, I'll be left with what is, you know, the carrying value or the net book value or the closing value. So that value is what I'm going to need to take to the balance sheet. So let's just quickly do that. So I'm going to come in here, pick the loan. So closing value. I pick it quick. Going to drag it all the way to the right. So good. And then deferred income tax. So if you calculated it, if you want to calculate it, this is where you will calculate it. But like I told you, it's a lot less confusing if you just leave it as if you don't know, because that value comes from the fact that when government taxes you eventually, the amount they will tax you is different from the amount that you have in your here. So the situation is one of the difference between what you have on your accounting book and what government eventually tax you can lead to one of two things. Either you are the underpaid, like you paid less than what government taxed you. What do I mean? Let me rephrase. You have in your book here, what you have in your book is less. If it is less than what the government tax you, then it comes like you have a a liability. I got that right. Yeah. So it will be as if you have a liability, you deferred income tax liability. And if it's a case where by the time government eventually taxed you following their capital allowance structure, you in your book have recognized a lot more money than what the government has taxed you, then that means like you have paid even more than what you are supposed to pay currently. And so you will have it as an asset. So it will come under deferred tax assets, which if you remember, we had that line item in this well broken down one, deferred tax line. So the trick is, how will you ever really know? Yes, it's possible, but sometimes it's not worth all the stress because you can never get it accurately. We all know government now. You know, even when you calculate it correctly, they will still say, no, this one is disallowed, this one is blah, blah. So sometimes it's just best to not give yourself a headache that is not worth the value, and then just whatever you've always have on your book, just maintain it like that. So in my own case, you will notice that that's kind of what I did. I just said, whatever government is taxing us is exactly what we have calculated in our book. So there's no difference. So which means I'm not going to be having a deferred tax in income, whether asset or liability being generated for my forecast model. Let me use that word. So anyway, the formula is straightforward. It's simply whatever you have on your book last year, plus whatever in your model you have used to account for an increase in the deferred tax. So in my case, because I never try to give myself unnecessary headache, it's coming as blank. I don't have anything.
Please, that hello.
Is... Yes,
please,
sir.
Can you try to explain that one again on deferred tax stuff?
Okay, so let us try to do it together. If you're a tax expert in the house, please feel free to chip in. So let's look at it. Imagine that your company name, so let's say Akim Limited. So now your books, let's try to cook your book. Different years, 2019, 2020. Now let's say all this money, they are in millions. That saves us stress of typing huge numbers. In 2019, let's say you made a revenue of 100 million. Nice round figure. Your cost of sales was 40 million. Your gross profit then. Your gross profit is going to be 60 million. Maybe you should put this one in brackets so that makes it easy to calculate. Comma style. Comma style, no decimal. Very good. So I say it's like this. Let me give it a top order. So it's looking your operating expenses. Let's say it's 30 million. Again, let me just put it in 30 million. So your operating profits. That's, let me just do a proper formula here. So your operating profit is going to be this plus this. Now let's say finance costs. Let's say you don't have loans. So let's not stress ourselves. You don't have any loan on your books. You are not getting any finance income. So let's come to the main part, profit before tax. Okay, good. So all of this, summation of all of this. Good. So let's say tax rate is this is our normal Nigerian tax rate, but let me just use 30% so that it's easy to have some round figures. So this one, let's say, is constant. Okay. Then the tax you eventually pay because of that tax rate. So the tax expense, tax you carry on your book, is going to be equal to this times this. I want to make it come in minus so that all expenses reflect minus. For now, let's just not drag it since I didn't drag the others. So your profit after tax, net profit, is obviously this and this. Okay, good. Now, okay, good. So in this your books now, when you go to tax office, so what is tax office going to say? Tax office will say, so let's say this is your first year of business. Okay, so it makes things easy. What is tax office going to say? Tax office will say, can you give us all your capital expenditure? Okay, so this is your capital expenditure by the different category of items. Okay, so what they do is your first year, and then there's what we call subsequent years, annual allowance. So let me explain it. Let me pull up. I think I have a where is my internet browser? Okay, this is it. So Nigeria, let's type it together. It's not difficult to find, so let me just type it together. Let's look at it together. Nigeria tax allowance. Allowance. So it's because it's different for a different asset type. That's why I want us to look at it together. So whenever you, it's not your work anyway, but since you've asked the question, I want to show us. So there's initial allowance. So let's call it initial allowance. It's the first year allowance anyway. So initial allowance, and then there's annual allowance. So they will take all of your different expenditure, qualifying expenditure anyway. So if you bought a building now, right? You bought a building, let's say a building. You bought a building for, I don't know, 50 million naira. So let's say every money we are talking about is a million, so that life is easy for us. Huh? You bought a building for 50 million naira. If you look at the book here, so can see what happens. They will allow you to take 15% as initial allowance. So it means that you're going to have to take, okay, anyhow, we'll type it like that, 15%. I wanted to see if there's somewhere we can write that figure separately, but no problem. And then every other year, you'll be taking 10%, see? Until the thing is off your book. So 10%. So this is how they are going to spread until the whole 50 million is gone. Okay. But what do most of us do in our depreciation? What happens is that we will have done a depreciation that does not follow any of this thing at all. Most of us do straight line depreciation. So if I'm taking that this building, I'm going to depreciate it over 20 years, then what would I have done, right? I would have just done 50 divided by 20. Boom. And this is what I'm going to be spreading over the years. I'm saying this is what I'm paying for that building, okay? So good. Now, furniture, plant, blah, blah, blah. You see the whole thing, but because of time, let's say what you have next. Plants, motor vehicle, as soon as I say, blah, blah. So let's just say what you have next are things that fall under this 50% annual allowance. Okay, I don't even understand the slash 95 unless we go and read what it is. Okay, 95% for motor vehicles for public transportation. Okay, your own is not public transportation. If the plant is for agricultural production, 95%. Okay, so ordinary plant and vehicle are always 50%. So let's say that's what you have, your PP&E. Let's say you spend 200 million. So they will allow you to take 50% of it for the first year. And then you are going to take what's left now. If you take 50%. Okay, good. So you spread the remaining equal amount over the useful lifetime. I was worried, why is it zero? So that could be 25. So 25%, you spread the remaining over the remaining this. Minus this times 25%. Okay. So let's say these are all your capital expenditure, right? So for you, you would have calculated a depreciation. That is, let's say this PP&E, you are depreciating over 10 years, okay? 10 years. So your own total depreciation would have been 10 years. So this is your first year, 2020. Okay, good. So what you're having is that as far as government is concerned, your allowable deduction is this. For 2019, 2020. Anyway, I don't need to repeat the years anyway. So what that means is in your book, you have worked with this. Let's say I took out depreciation as a completely separate line. Let's say we took out depreciation as a separate line. So let's say out of all this cost of sales, 4 million. So you did 22 million. So building this PP&E now, and some of, anyway, just to make our life easy, let's say 10 million out of this is D&A. So 10 million, come here, it. The remaining 11 or what now? In fact, maybe. So 12.5. So here, actually, yeah, 12.5. That's when we're using figures that are not round to, you know what? Let us change this guy to something that will make my life easy. Let's say this guy is 40. So let me just say another 10 million from here is what is our depreciation. So now I've taken out the depreciation. So this is that. Not 10 million. This one should be. So it will now be 22. Good. 22 million. So this is how you cooked your book, right? But what does government do? Government say, nope. We are going to remove 106, right? So by the time government removes 106, what is my figures are too high. Let's say this one is 20 million. So that we'll have something small that we can be able to do. Good. Let me just say this is minus 38. Minus 28. And then this will be minus 4. Okay, good. So we are back to the same figure, but now much more manageable. All right. So I hope I've not confused anybody. This is our depreciation. What did I do? I took them out of here because they are usually embedded in cost of sales and OPEX. So I took them out separately. So you now have depreciation separately. So this is your accounting tax. For your first year, this is what you put. But now this is, we need to do what government will do. Government is going to say, and nope, we are not going to follow what you have done. So government is going to do their own. So this was what figure? This was 34. So government is going to say, no. This DNA, which is like capital allowance, we are not following your own. We are going to do our own. Right? And our own is equal to this. Right? So by the time we do that, what is happening? You are going to, in your book here, you say you are going to pay 9 million. But when government now finally taxes you, it's 5 million. So what's now the, what has happened? So this one is called tax paying. This is the eventual tax you pay, okay, or government tax or whatever grammar you want to call it. So this is actually what you pay. So in your book, you carried tax, 9 million. Government billed you 5 million. So that difference of 4 million, that difference, 4 million, is what is that our deferred tax? Okay. So it's now a case of, is it an asset or a liability? So let's think about it. Or what do you want to, anybody wants to answer, what do you think? Is it an asset? What's DNA? DNA is depreciation. In fact, the name is even longer than DNA. It used to be DDNA, depletion, so, and amortization. So let me just write the full name. All right, DNA, whatever you want to call it. So what do you think? Will this be an asset or a liability? Anybody want to give it a shot?
It's a liability.
Okay, so we are getting multiple answers. Mr. Sadiq and Mr. Akim say it's a liability. Mr. Desumbo says it's an asset. If you remember, you deducted from your book 9 million that you have paid 9 million. Actually, you paid 5 million because that's what government eventually taxed you. You have kind of paid more now. You've paid more than what government taxed you. Over time, you will eventually, because the timing difference, over time, you will never pay more than the amount of what you bought. Over time, all of you will recognize this money. It's just how quickly or slowly you are recognizing it that is different. Government have their own way of recognizing it, either because they want to incentivize some industry or whatever. That's what you will notice here. They want people who are in agriculture or in some kind of industry to not pay tax immediately. So they let them carry a higher portion of their cost. So that way they will not pay tax. Hopefully their tax will be less in the first couple of years. Like actually their cash flow anyway. They won't have to remove money to pay tax. So let me show us how to make it a lot easy to know whether it will come as a tax or as a as an increase or as a decrease or as an asset or as a liability, right? So shall I explain first on paper? Time is up. Let me just explain it on with word of mouth. So this is it. Time to be corrected. But if I pay 9 million naira, right? And the government billed me 5 million naira, then I have overpaid. I have paid more than what's so it's just as if I borrow a I rent a house and I paid for 2 years or I paid for more than what I should have paid this year. You know how we used to call it like it's as if I've done a prepaid expense, you know, and that's like an asset, like I paid ahead for something I'm not going to enjoy. So in my book now, if this is what I'm showing, that this is what went out, but from my cash flow, actually, if this is what went out, no, let me revamp it. My cash flow, this is what went out. My book, this is what, oh, you are correct, it's a liability. This is what you, money that went out, this is what you showed in your books. Yeah, it's a liability. Almost confused myself. So it's a liability. All right, so let's move on. Where were we? My time is almost up. So, okay, good. I hope we are clear with that part. So, some of all of this, I'm looking at my time. I have 5 more minutes. Then, current liability. The company doesn't have any short-term loan because I am the one that modeled the company. So, they don't have any short-term loan. Or, yeah, they don't. Okay. Let me point to it. Bank overdraft, closing bank overdraft. Closing bank overdraft. To close that one. And then working capital to go grab the payables. Other current liabilities. Let's go grab it from here. Okay. And then from there, I'm able to grab the total current liabilities. Okay. And then equity, the share capital. So equity, I have a sheet where it shows how much money you raise as equity, whether preference and ordinary. So the closing values are the equity value themselves, the share capital with premium anyway. So we actually add the share capital and premium because quote from my equity sheet. Can I explain? Is this seasonality you said? I'm not sure I got what you typed, Mr. Akim.
Seasonality.
Is it as regarding revenue or expense or how?
I saw it on some some model when they said seasonality, so it will not affect the revenue. That you now said like something like seasonality factor that it may affect our revenue projection, something like that. To they just multiply it to, they just factor into some model. I think I've seen some model like that.
Okay. So there is one model I worked on last month, entering this month. So they are into real estate leasing and hotels, hospitality generally, but their own hospitality is not just a normal house, it's senior livings anyway. So the first person who had done the model used this thing you are saying, seasonality. So he said high season is in the summer period. I think maybe that's when people are on vacation and they rent hotel a lot. So that period, occupancy, he didn't even use say occupancy rate to be higher. What he said was they were going to be able to charge higher. So it broke the year into three periods. So it broke in the year into low season, high season, medium season. Low season is, I can't remember, let's say, I think the low season is the period immediately after summer. I think when you have finished summer, you have finished traveling, and everybody goes back for Christmas and all. And so I think that part was the low season. So most people are not in a hotel and all of that. They put the price lower. So let's say the rooms are going for $200 per day at the low season, $300 per day at the high season, $250 per day at the one that is not low, is not high. Okay. Yeah, use it. But for me, that thing is just complicating the model, because for you to use it now, you have to model monthly. You know, you have to. So for me, what I used to take is I take average, whatever the average we are pricing. The same way, if you, I work sometimes for, I help salespeople in FMCG. They are the king of seasonality. Nestle, Coca-Cola, and all of them, they don't sell the same volume every month. Rainy season, people drink more tea. So obviously, volume will be higher. Even price is the same. Then, hot season, I don't think you want to be drinking hot tea inside sun again or when you are feeling hot. So, but when we're doing the modeling, we don't start going that weekly or monthly granular of seasonality. It's good if you are just projecting, maybe if someone has done the financial model, you now want to cascade it as a salesperson to how your team will eat the sales value. So you are now spreading the target, and you cannot spread the target equally, because if you spread it equally, it's not going to make sense. There will be months where they will meet the target without doing anything, because that's the high season. And then there will be months where they will, no matter what they do, they will never meet target, because that's the low season. So yes, cascading the big value down for the department that needs to generate the revenue, that seasonality, the demand planning, they even have demand planning departments. Yes, that can be their work. They even use it not just for sales alone, they use it also for production, so that they won't go and overproduce, so that they won't just go and produce more than what the market can absorb. So they use it for both sales and logistics, supply chain and all. But when it comes to the financial modeling, talking from my own side, I always average things out. I can't be carrying all those monthly. Some even do it weekly. Week one will be high, week two will be low, because they expect that if I come and sell to you, you're a retailer, and I sell to you this week, obviously you probably will not buy next week, because you will take this week and next week to sell the one I've supplied you. Then when I come 2 weeks time, so it's not even, it's even worse than just a monthly breakdown. The most accurate one for them in the FMCG is a weekly breakdown, high week, low week, and then there's now a general period of the year where you will now raise everything again. The high week will have a higher value, the low week will still have a higher value than. I don't do all those ones, so I just do average. They will cascade it themselves. Okay. Because the moment you do that one, you start doing your model monthly. Imagine I want to do 5-year forecast. I'm now doing it 6 months. If I'm, I don't know, it's possible, but I don't usually use that approach because the thing becomes too cumbersome and can never be accurate anyway. So you just get complexity that does not add much value. I just go with average. Other equity. We don't have any other equity line item. Equity. Then total liabilities and equity. This one plus this one plus this one. So I'm going to drag this all the way. Okay. It's not supposed to be showing you cube. Oh yeah. I've done this thing on a customer work. I form if the absolute. That customer now I've used the work like that. There's error in my formula. So anyway, you will see that forget all these ones that are empty. When everything is empty, they will balance. Empty is equal to empty now. But starting from year 2019, where figures are there, you see they are not balancing. And the reason they are not balancing is your cash flow statement needs to feed back here. So cash is a very simple formula. Simple formula, but process might not be simple anyway. Cash that you have in your bank right now is equal to the cash that you have at the end of last year. You know, at midnight, December 31, whatever was in your bank balance, this one. Plus, so far this year, what money have you made, whether plus or negative? You know, so what's the net money you have made this year? That one comes from the cash flow. So plus the net cash flow this year. So that's the formula. Last year plus net cash flow this year. So that formula is what we drag. And once we drag it, if the balance sheet should balance, okay? So now, to top it, a question.
I think that same pattern that you use for cash and cash equivalent is what we also use for retained, right? That
yes.
We have to add the gain of last year to the profit we make this year.
Yes, then minus dividend. So that was why I did this one separate. So if you look at it here, last year, retained any. Let me zoom. So last year retained any, I had profit this year, but because it's from retained any, you pay dividend. So I now remove whatever dividend, and then closing. But you are correct. I'm just saying that whenever there's dividend, you have to also remember to factor in that it's from retained any dividend go out from, or from net income anyway. So, but you are correct, sir. Okay. So now, question to wrap up. Whenever this thing does not balance, there are two usual cases. Why my own balance is very straightforward. The trick is this. If you break your work, if you break it very granularly, if you break them in such that everything is so well broken and revenue is in its own sheet, cost of sales, it might look like hard work. But it's a work that is simple. It's just, let me just say, it's as if somebody is laying out his plan very well. Yes, when the person is laying it out, you might be like, all this time you have spending to lay it out, I will have already even almost finished my income statement. Well, the person will suffer for it when he's doing balance sheet and cash flow. So when you have laid all your stuffs out like this, the advantage is that When you come here, you will not be having to do complex formulas again. You will just be picking them. See the way we pick the plant property and equipment. Somebody who has done what I have done of laying it out in depreciation sheet, what has it done? It has put in the capital expenditure. It has calculated the depreciation. It has brought in whatever was existing in the book, even last year and whatever. And then what does it do? Okay, well, my current book value will always be equal to my last year's book value plus whatever additional purchase I made minus total depreciation I have taken. Now, because I have done all of that here, I don't need to now be doing that complex formula here. Because the more complex your formula, the more chances of error. You will now be doing, imagine I'm not doing all that thing in one formula here. You know, even if you are looking to trace errors, if it becomes more complex to trace, why? Your formula is doing a lot of things together. Okay? So, one of my colleagues is calling me and I don't know. I'll tell him to just message me. Yeah. If I am in a session, message me, right? Is it about the session? Message. Sorry. His call must be urgent. It's part of the webinar organizer. So whenever stuffs go wrong, that's number one thing. People I see when they tell me there's error in their model, I should help them review. Almost every time I see that they are using a complex approach where I've seen some people, what they do is just three sheets, one sheet, two sheets, three sheets. Now, let me tell you what they put in their three sheets. The financial statements is in one sheet. Balance sheet, cash flow, and income statement. Then they call one workings. Sometimes some people call it calculations. So that one has all of what me I have spread across all these, like how many sheets, 10 sheets. They just put everything in these workings. So their Excel file, everything will now be long down that you'll be getting to row 200. Yes. When it works, it's beautiful. But the problem is that except you are very, very meticulous, Chai, the opportunity to make mistake is higher. Then worst case is debugging. Debugging is not going to be easy because everything, me now, if I go here and I see an error somewhere and I suspect it is here and I click here, I'll say, oh, this is coming from working capital. But in their own now, when they click, everything is always coming from the same working sheet. So more complexity, that's number one. I said three sources of errors I see people always have. Number two, there are some problem portions. I'm going to try to color them. Problem portion number one is all these expenses that can be depreciated. So if you have calculated your depreciated wrong, your depreciation wrongly, these ones will never be correct. There's that one. Then number two is, is this retained any side? Some people forget that they might pay dividend or they forget to add profit. So these two places are the places I also see in the balance sheet that people have errors. So the third one is now this one, cash flow. And why this one is a problem spot in itself is cash flow is coming from an entire complete sheet. So any error here ultimately leads to an error here. Well, most times any error here leads. So when I've checked this one and this one, and I see that they are not the source of the error, I just go and get a good chair, relax, and just focus on this one, you know, because that means most likely the error is coming from here. But not to say that all these ones don't cause error, also cause. But these ones are not, I'm just talking about the common ones. So if most times what I just do is I check here to check that depreciation is not the problem. I check here that the person is calculating the retained earnings very well. After I've done that, I go here to view menu. I do new window. I make them stay together. Let me check what my colleague that was calling me was trying to say. I hope it's not like the internet is burning or something is happening. Okay, I think I know what you said. The session that we have next. So, what do I do now? All these lines, I just carry my sheet here, put it in working capital, and just be eyeballing them. Is the figures here? Are the figures here looking like the figures here? Because this one is just copy and paste kind of stuff. So if they are matching, this one doesn't take time because you are just looking with your eyes. And the figures you are seeing here, are they matching here? Boom. If they match, you will know. It doesn't take time. Then same thing too. This one here, I look at it. Are these figures here matching here? Okay. So that's that one. Then debts. Debts, most times debts don't have issue because debts usually have a round figure. So if you make, and it's usually huge. So when you make mistake, you don't imagine I'm looking at long term and seeing 2 naira or 10 naira. We know that something is already, so you will know it even before you finish most times. Because of time, let me just reiterate. These are the hotspots, this and this together, right? And then this one, but this one is problematic because you now have to go to look at the entire cash flow. Okay. How did you do that? Comparing sheets in the same workbook. Okay, let me do that again. So, how do you compare sheets in the same workbook? Maybe I'm here in the balance sheet. I go to View, New Window, see your new window. When I do it, you see this is my name here. The name of my sheet here, of my file, something will happen to it. It will have, just watch, something will happen to it. So let's do it. New window, under view menu, new window. Let me point at it. Under view, new window. I want you to watch here. Watch what will happen to this name. Good. So let's go on. So, new window, boom. Have you seen that this name has changed to 2? Okay, so that means there is 1. So let's check out. If I drag this 2, I drag it to my left. This is left actually, left pops up there. This is the 1, I can put the 1 beside it. So can you see, I have 2 and I have 1. 2, 1. I can navigate to any sheet I want. And I'll be seeing those 2 different sheets at the same time. And I can change things and it will affect. If I color this face mask, if I color it blue, right? If I go to that sheet that has the face mask, you see the color has changed to blue. Let's see. That's changed. If I change the color here back, maybe I change it to orange. Changes here. So it's the same sheet. Everything happens to it together. So thank you very much. I think I have to close the session now. I said I was going to send us some file. Let me just send it once and for all. Save. Good. Storage account. Haha! We are supposed to do today's giveaway. Last week, the person who won, the person left the session because when I went and checked the stuff, the person had left the session. So we are going to do another giveaway. So the same prize that the person of last week should have won, we'll just give to whoever is the winner today, so that the person's prize will not waste. The person who gave us the gift will not, like, it won't be as if we did not use the gift. So what would be today's question then? Let's pick something that will be fair enough. As long as anybody paid attention, they will get it. Said I was going to give us this and PwC documents. Mr. Sadiq. Okay, good. Not I think I know who will be the winner for today's gift, or what will be the criteria for winning for today's gift. So Mr. Adesumbo has helped us with the question. So the answer, whoever types the answer first is going to be the winner. His question is that, how is it that the 4 million deferred tax is a liability? So this stuff, I'll bring it up back. This is what he's saying. This stuff we did here where in your book, you carried 9 million. But when government assessed you, you paid 5 million. That difference of 4 million, he's saying, how come? How is it a liability? Anybody wants to answer? So whoever answers it is going to be our winner for the gift. Mr. Adesumbo, you are the one that will pick the winner. So whichever answer that you understood or that you think makes sense to you, just go and like it. When you like it, that's the person that has won. And if you think nobody answered you properly, then let us know. I will also try and go online. Let me just upload all the things I need to upload. So if I go online, maybe I might see something where somebody has explained it very well too. PwC document. So, Mr. Adesumbo, oh yeah, did they try? Are you okay with the answer you are seeing? Okay, Mr. Adesumbo has picked our winner for today. So thank you very, very much. I'm going to Mr. Chibuzo, please send your email. Just email us at webinar@yourbizedge.com for your prize award. So what's your prize award? Last week's presenter, she gave us a book, our own book, and then we took our own course. So let me just first of all give the material for today so that everybody can go their way. Material for today, copy. So practice file. This is the practice file. Hey, what am I press? So, like I've pressed jaga. I'll send it again. Practice file is supposed to be this. Copy URL. And the PwC IFRS book, this is it. Of the financial statement that we used. So Mr. Chibuzo, this is the prize you have won. Let me just show you. The prize you have won is courtesy your BizEdge. You've won our financial modeling class course, this financial modeling evaluation course. So, and courtesy our lab, and have a very nice week ahead. I need to go and set up the next session. So bye bye, and don't forget to let me quickly let us know if you are planning to take the exam for financial modeling, advanced financial modeler. So let me give you the code. You have a 40% discount code. So thank you very much. Any comments, any suggestions? I'm also supposed to tell us to help with the feedback. Let me just quickly do that too before my team guys complain that I'm always forgetting it. So please help us with your feedback. So those are the only two things I'm weighing off. The exam is coming up this October 23. If you are interested in taking the exam, then please definitely use this discount code so that you don't pay the full amount. You pay slightly above half the amount. So thank you very, very much and have a nice Sunday ahead on Fine Excel. So the speaker is what my colleague was calling me about. The speaker wanted to get the special account he needs to use to log in to Teams. So if you're interested too, the speaker is going to be taking us on Lambda formulas. Excel.